I'm with Pam Shriver. We're watching Hannah Mamlakova's daughter Ellie compete at the U.S. Open Juniors. And Pam, you were a top junior growing up. What are you seeing that's the same, and what are you seeing that's different from when you were coming through?
Well, it's the same. There's a lot of young kids that have their eye on being professional tennis players. And the pathway's really changed. I actually never played a junior major. I played the nationals, and I played maybe only six or eight junior tournaments a year at the national level. Maybe I played one or two for Mid-Atlantic. My freshman year of high school, I was still playing varsity basketball. So a lot's changed. The game expects, most games expect really specialization. Mm-hmm. I have mixed feelings about it. I think it's good for some. I think it can cause others to not prosper the way they might if they stuck with maybe one other sport for a little longer. But certainly by the time these kids are playing the junior U.S. Open, they do need to be specializing. They have to realize that the length of the careers are getting longer and longer, and then it's really no longer a sprint to get. Like when Ellie's mom and I competed together in the late 70s and 80s, it was a sprint. It was kind of like, how good were you as a team? But now, people are peaking in their mid to late 20s and well into their 30s. So you got to manage it over decades,
right?
Not years.
Right. And so where does college tennis play into the process now?
Well, I think, again, based on the individual, I think college tennis with the right matchup, with the right coach and the right program is really good for many developing young pros who have the eye on the professional game. Obviously, they have to play collegiate tennis as an amateur. I think it's still a little bit more, probably a better idea more often on the men's side because of females tend to develop strength and grow into adulthood at a little bit of an earlier age than men do. Boys develop into men. But to be honest, it also depends on the emotional maturity of each and every team. What are your interests? And at the end of the day, even back, whether it was McEnroe going 1 year to Stanford or a lot of players, Kathy Jordan became top pros, did go to college. Elise Bergen, my best friend from Baltimore, I played juniors with from 10 and under, so all the way through. She had a 4-year scholarship, won NCAAs at Stanford, and played the tour for 12 years. So that model is great for some, but getting out on the tour earlier, or using the ITF junior tournaments as a launching pad, and I know things are being tweaked as we speak in the juniors. But we also have to remember what the Williams sisters did. They hardly played at all.
Right.
Except they were working on their game. They were developing their game. And one thing that I do know is that most often, players have a hard time working on their game and developing better technique when they're in a season where they're competing.
Mm-hmm.
They're too afraid to tinker. So when you think about what Richard Williams had in mind for his daughters, it's really hard to argue that that's not a reasonable pathway for more than just being a sister.
Right. What do you think about the fact that the juniors are allowed on-court coaching?
Well, look, my kids have been involved with virtually every youth sport imaginable, and there isn't one youth sport I've been involved with other than tennis that makes coaching difficult. They play team tennis,
mm-hmm.
where they can have coaching, but obviously at the USTA level they can't, except for at the end of the split sets before the third set starts. I think for young people to learn in competition, they need to have coaching in competition. And I actually feel that it's something that's very hard to police. I feel like it's hard to, capture the coaching that's going on that's it's illegal.
Right.
So why not make it with the right boundaries and the right rules, make it legal? And I think kids will learn more and maybe not feel as much stress and feel like they're alone. Because we want kids and young people to enjoy not only the preparation to compete, but we want them to enjoy competing. And sometimes, depending on the individual, competing all by yourself out there is especially when you're young, it's not a lot of fun.
Right, right. What about the argument that it's going to create a greater divide between the haves and have-nots in our sport that's already incredibly expensive?
Bottom 13.
Well, it's a problem in almost every area of life, isn't it?
It is, yeah, sure.
So if you're going to start with junior coaching and you can't do it, look, it would be up to, if you don't have a coach, it would be up to, just like sometimes on the rink, players have their friends or a coach of a friend. Mm-hmm. You can find somebody that you have trust in a relationship with. If you don't, or you can choose to go it alone, guess what? You may be just as well off as the person who's being coached. So I don't, it doesn't matter to me. Maybe the ITF should have some handful of lessons. Some long term campaign partners now. I think the ITF, for the nations who can't afford to send their own coach, they ought to be a pool of ITF. Neutral coaches that will coach any player from any nation who doesn't have a designated coach.
Brilliant idea. I love that. All right, so I'm going to let you get back to watching the match, but before I do, one last piece of advice to tennis parents out there?
Well, it's a piece of advice I have a hard time with. Sometimes it's just knowing when to open your mouth and knowing when to keep your mouth shut, and more times than not, you're better off listening and asking questions and be an active listener to your child. And it better be their dream, their desire. Obviously, you need to support and encourage and fund and, you know, help in every way you can. But if it's not what they want in their heart, then guess what? It's not going to work.
Love it. Thank you, Pam Shriver.
Thank you.